A Winter's Journey by Ben Sunderland, with illustration by Andrew Barrington. Part 2, The Acorn Stag. Buoyed by owls telling of the kindness of strangers, the animals set off, focusing on that promise of safe routing through the mire of this place. And such safety actually wasn't hard to find, as their path down from the higher lands was guided neatly into thick arteries of foliage, oases of home that offered thick vegetation underfoot and crowded shrubbery and planting above. The animals' navigation was one of safe, protected isolation, each silently grateful for their own slower way of existing, now that they'd seen the sharp, accelerated contrast lived by other alien creatures elsewhere in the world. They soon passed through the foreign world in benign isolation, the refuge ribbons delivering them into the Great Plains, which stretched across the other side of the valley and formed the grand approach to Thousand Year Wood. The Great Plains led them on until the open space began to be steadily crowded by a guard of tall trees, such that the animals had never seen in Oak Nook before. These tall sentinels formed a guiding channel towards the main entrance of Thousand Year Wood, which was itself marked by a vast, towering arch made of the twisting limbs of a colossal redwood, whose arms hung like wooden chandeliers suspended high in the air above. Owl smiled in recognition as he spied the little bird waiting underneath the arch to greet them. Robin reclined in the lower branches, his rusted breast shining proudly as he eyed Owl with a mischievous grin. "The years have written their story on your face, old friend," he said. "I see all the meals have been telling theirs to your round belly," laughed Owl in response, before wrapping his old friend in a feathery embrace. Robin waved the animals through the arch and guided them into the forest depths, and they were only too grateful to have him. For in every direction massed a milling throng of animals of all sizes, colours and shapes. The air fizzed with the sense of occasion, ripened by that giddy sort of relieved tiredness that comes at the end of a long journey. Many had travelled even further than Oak Nook, representing communities flung wide across the kingdom, all gathered in a great temporary animal city that spread throughout the forest. Robin settled his guests for the evening. Each wanted for nothing, with little and old bedded, warmed and snug, filled with an endless supply of heart to eat and cheer to drink. Not without good reason did the Stag Council have a legendary reputation for hospitality and welcome. As with tradition, the coronation was to take place as the day's first shadow was cast from a great towering rock that dominated the skyline of Thousand Year Wood's highest point. Known as the Masthead, the rock had played host to countless similar ceremonies over the generations and was to witness the crowning of another today. Rousing travel-wearied animals in the middle of the night was no easy task, and Oak Nook stumbled bleary-eyed up the hillside until wakefulness and excitement began to energize sleepy brains and dozing bones as curiosity took over. They joined a steadily growing number ascending the masthead as the great gathering took their place inside the clearing. The strains of dawn teased the horizon as Robin finally called the assembly to order. He was perched on top of the font itself, a particularly large rock that formed the focal point of the masthead. It had a curiously smooth, flat surface. Scanning the scene before him, Robin took a moment to enjoy the sight. Spread in their hundreds, species of all kinds looked back at him. Winged, feathered, furred, hooved, clawed and taloned. Young and not so young, small with large and bright necks to camouflaged. If any human eyes chanced upon the scene that day, they would have gazed in wonder. Great hordes of animals gathered in quiet communion. The majesty of the deer herds, with the hedge birds borrowing their antlers as temporary perches for an elevated view. The sharp-nosed foxes and hares settled next to one another in mutual ceasefire, while the magnificent birds of prey cradled the mice, the voles and the shrews, offering them a better view in turn. All throughout the clearing, animals shared the same air in quiet respect of one another. Then, from the bleached and weathered pages of an ancient book he cradled between his feathers, Robin began. The words he read cast a spell on the crowd as they listened. He led them through the formal proclamations, his shrill voice carrying the ageless words lightly to every hanging ear, until, pausing in his flow, he finally turned his beady eyes towards Ossian, standing quietly with his mother. Robin motioned for them both to join him. He then turned to Owl, Buzzard, Hawk, and Eagle, the elders. They each came forward to lay four matching acorns at Ossian's mother's feet. The acorns were of the deepest brown, nearly incandescent in the sharpening dawn light. From their hue, it could be seen that they were old, very old. In fact, these acorns were the very first to be shed by Owl's old oak, the oak of Oak Nook. Collectively, they were known as the spring, for they represented the future, and those entrusted with their safekeeping were tasked with the future and longevity of all the animal kingdom. The elders had each looked after their respective acorns since Ossian's father's own coronation, and the time had now come for them to be handed on to the next generation. Ossian's mother gathered them gently and held them aloft for all to see. Here lies hope. Here lies newness. Here lies future. The words hung as though she had written their very shape into the still morning air itself. And it felt like time stood still with them, before, eventually, she turned and spoke to her son. Let those that keep them know them. Let those that seek them find them. And let those that need them be them. These the seeds of spring. With that, she laid them on the ground in front of Ossian and met his pressing nose with hers in a public display of the love that ran deep between them. Ossian himself then dipped his great muscular hind legs and sprang himself atop the font. He stood tall above the gathering, such that even the animals right at the back could see him clearly. He turned to Robin, and in keeping with the same tradition followed by his father and grandfather and countless generations before, recited the same ancient words they had spoken on their own special days. I thank my mother for bearing me. I thank the forest for raising me. And now I ask its help in leading me. Who will be my elders and carry these seeds of spring? In response, Robin ushered four young animals onto the font. They had been chosen many months previously during a secret meeting at Oak Nook with Owl and the other elders, who now each retrieved their acorn from the font and turned to their young counterparts. Hawk gave his to Leverett, the smallest of Hare's sprawling throng of youngsters, while Buzzard's was dropped into the sleek, bright paw of Red, Mr. and Mrs. Foxy's eldest cub. Eagle gave hers to Kit of Beaver Hall. Owl turned to Young Squirrel and placed his acorn gently into the tiny waiting paw with a smile before turning back to the gathering. Without another word, he turned his wide eyes to the sky, spread wide his wings, and began to offer a loud hooting up into the morning. This was joined by calls from the three other elders before Robin's shrill tweeting called all of the assembled animals into a voluminous chorus. Soon, Oshin and his four new elders were surrounded by a symphony of barks, calls, whistles, and bellows as the animals announced their coming of age and a new chapter in the life of the kingdom. The morning air rang in concert as Owl and Robin slipped unnoticed from the throng. Robin waited on the fringe of the clearing as Owl turned his gaze back to the animals behind one last time. The winter breeze rippled its chill underneath his tattered feathers and across his old bowed back as he watched the unfolding celebration. Then, turning, he accepted Robin's outstretched feather and followed his old friend's lead as the pair faded into the golden white glow of Thousand Year Wood's welcoming and well-earned embrace.